Everyone who has been listening to this show on satellite or on WWCR since its inception on the 4th of May, 1982, they already know this, but I know that there's many new listeners out there tonight. So I'm going to give you this admonition, and you must obey it no matter what. You must not believe anything that you hear on this show, or on the Chuck Carter show, or on the Tom Valentine show, or on Larry King Live, or from the lips of Dan Rather, or George Bush, or Bill Clinton, or anyone else in this entire world, whether you hear it on radio, or on television, or from the lips of someone standing right in front of you. But you must listen to everyone, no matter who they are or what they are saying. For that is the true mark of intelligence. Listen to everything, believe nothing until you can prove you yourself. You must learn how to find the truth and prove it. If you can't do that, you might as well turn off your radio now. If you have to call someone else to ask if you should be listening to this show, you should turn off your radio now. We don't even want you to listen. Understand, folks, that only free-thinking, intelligent people who are prepared to root through all the crap and get at the truth should be listening to this show and nobody else. My admonition is the same with reading, whether it be newspapers, or books, or tea leaves, I don't care what it is. Read everything, believe nothing, until you can prove through your own efforts whether it is true or false, or lies somewhere in between in the many shades of gray. If you don't do this, if you cannot do this, or will not do this, or just plain too lazy to do this, then I can assure you that you will march into the New World Order as a docile slave. Bah. Buying all the way. For only free-thinking people who listen to everything and read everything ever come close to the truth, and I can assure you that it is elusive. Everyone else are just puppets on the end of someone's string, and when that person pulls that string, those puppets dance right on cue, because that's exactly what they are supposed to do.
Investigative reporting is being sort of squeezed out of the picture, and I think intentionally, because it tends to ruffle feathers. I mean, good investigative reporting does ruffle feathers. And it draws lawsuits, and it gets newspapers in trouble.
Old pirates, yes, they rob I, sold I to the merchant ship.
My name's Gary Webb. I am an investigative journalist. I've been an investigative journalist for about 25 years for daily newspapers. And in 1996, I wrote a series of stories entitled Dark Alliance, which was about CIA involvement in drug trafficking. What my story showed was that the cocaine that was being sold in those neighborhoods was coming from mainly one source, and this one source was being used to finance a guerrilla war in Central America. The general idea of the CIA dealing drugs was something that the American mainstream press had never written about before, and that's why it prompted outrage among blacks, among drug reform activists, among politicians, by the CIA, by every federal agency involved in the drug war, because it showed they weren't doing their jobs, that it was a fraud. right after we published the stories, the support we got from the media was very favorable. Newsweek magazine did a big piece on the story and said it was well documented and well researched. The website was getting like a million hits a day. There were marches in Watts, there were marches in Compton, there were candlelight vigils. Every California senator demanded an official investigation. So the story itself is really building momentum. The government reaction was no reaction. And this, I believe, was a very careful strategy, because nobody was going to believe the government if they came out and said we didn't do it. The proof was fairly overwhelming, since we had all these government documents showing that it had happened. So what happened was they let the so-called liberal press speak for them. And they had the national security reporters at the Washington Post, who coincidentally used to work for the CIA, write stories saying, it doesn't mean anything. It was a distraction from what the story said, and it became sort of a media war between the Mercury News, which stood behind the story at that point, and the rest of the establishment media, who wanted us to back away from it. And part of that reason was because these major newspapers had written about this issue back in the 1980s, but had written about it very dismissively, as if this is nonsense, it doesn't happen, it never happened. And then 10 years later, we came back with documentation showing that it was absolutely true, and that it was worse than we thought. We had gotten a story out around them, and we had gotten it out in a big way that they couldn't control, and that was through the internet. And I think a lot of this was directed to the Mercury News to say, we don't care what documentation you have, we don't care what kind of story you've got, we set the national news agenda. And if we don't like your story, we will kill your story regardless of its truth. The media rejoiced when this came out, because it meant they had won. They had forced a newspaper to back away from a story that was true, simply because of this barrage of criticism, of mindless criticism, essentially, that really took its toll on the editors of the newspaper. And they were being seen as sort of outcasts from the club. And I think they made a political decision that it was better in the long run to take a dive on this story and get back in the good graces of the rest of the media. It was essentially a war between my editors and myself, because I wouldn't apologize for the story or back away from the story, and fought them on it publicly. And so they transferred me to a bureau that was 140 miles from where I lived, and I called in sick a lot. One of the things I'm proudest of in regards to that story is the website that the Mercury News set up, because it really was the first time that a newspaper brought its readers not only into the interior of the paper, but into the reporters' notebooks. You know, this was a story that, as I told my editors, had a very high unbelievability factor built into it. A lot of people were going to say, this can't be true. And this story became a sensation because of the website, not because of the story, but because people could get to it. And they could never have gotten to it before, because the San Jose Mercury News is a small regional newspaper in Northern California that you couldn't read if you lived in New York, or you couldn't read if you lived in LA. But this story you could read anywhere in the world and see all of our documentation. So it became, and we did this on purpose, to make it very hard to knock down, to make it very difficult for people to say this didn't happen. But they said it didn't happen anyway.
Pirates, yes, they rob I, sold I to the merchant ships. Minutes after they took I from the bottomless pit. But my hand was made strong by the hand of the Almighty. We forward in this generation triumphantly. Won't you help to sing these songs of freedom? 'Cause all I ever had, redemption songs, these songs of freedom, these songs of freedom.
Authentic journalism is telling people something that the government doesn't want them to know.